Hey, what's up guys? This is Friendly Developer here with yet another dynamic programming problem, and that is the subset sum problem. Like a lot of other problems that we have seen, this is also a very important problem which can help you understand dynamic programming problems in a much better context. Okay, so without further ado, let's get on with it. Let's look at the question. Given a set of non-negative integers, given a set of non-negative integers and a value sum, here in this example 9, we should determine whether there is a subset from the given set that will sum up to the given sum value. Okay, so here in this example we are given this big set of integers, and we need to find whether there is a small subset of numbers that can sum up to 9. Okay, so turns out that there is a subset, that is 4 and 5, which sum up to the value 9. Okay, so that is the problem. We should find a subset. In fact, we should find whether there exists a subset which sum up to the given sum value. Okay, so here this is our function. The function returns whether there exists a subset or not. And just like a lot of other problems in DP that we have seen, here also there is a choice that we can make. What I mean by that is, let's say when you directly start solving the problem, the confusion that you would find if you solve it manually is, for every element that you consider, you can just make two choices. Either you include that item and proceed, or you exclude that item. Okay, so essentially in dynamic programming, all we do is we first find the solutions to sub problems, that is smaller problems than the given problem, and try to use those solutions to the sub problems to find the solution to the given problem. Okay, let's see how we can achieve that. Let's call our function. So here we start by looking at the first element in our given array, that is the given set of integers. We look at the first element with an index 0, and let's pass the sum value here. Okay, this is our sum. Okay, one of the sub problems is corresponding to a choice where we include our first element, that is 3 in this example. Okay, when we include 3 in the solution set, we are essentially left with a sum value of 6. Okay, because we need to find a subset that sums up to value 9. When we include 3 in that subset solution, then that means from the remaining elements we just need to see if there is a subset that sums up to 6. Okay, because we have already included 3 out of 9. Okay, so let's solve that. Let's take that path of sub problem and first find a solution for that. Okay, we include 3. By including 3, our sub problem is just about 3 is the first element, the current element that we are looking at. Okay, by including 3, we are reducing the sum, and we go on looking at the next element in the array. Okay, now what does this value signify? The whole value of this expression, that is the value that will be stored in this variable, will mean that if it is true, that means by including 3, when we proceeded forward, we have found a subset from the I plus 1th element, from the second element onwards, which can sum up to 6. Okay, so that is one sub problem that is resulted by including 3. And the other sub problem, where we take the other choice, where we exclude 3. By excluding 3, we just go on looking at the next element onwards. So we move on to the next element, and our sum does not change because we are excluding the current element. Okay, so there is no subtraction to do. So this is one sub problem and this is one sub problem. So initially we started with the sub problem where our problem needed all the elements of this array to be considered. So we started with I is equal to 0, that is the first element. And for both the sub problems that we saw, we only considered the elements from the second element. Okay, we only considered from the I plus 1th element. So this sub problem consists of only these elements. And accordingly, we took the decision regarding what should be the value of sum. Okay, so just to inspect what it means, if our include variable was false, that means if the solution to this sub problem was false, that means there does not exist any subset out of these set of elements. That is, from the second element onwards, there is no subset of elements which can sum up to 6. Okay, 9 minus the current element 3, that is 6. Similarly, for exclude, if this solution is true, that means by excluding 3, we just needed to find a subset from this second element that summed up to value 9. Okay, in fact, if you see this problem, we can see 4 and 5 sum up to 9. Similarly, for including decision, by including 3 here from the second elements onwards, we have a subset 4 and 2 which will sum up to 6. Okay, 4 and 2. So here in this example, both include and exclude will become true. Okay, now we have found our sub problems. We have the solutions to our sub problems. Now we just need to combine the solutions to the sub problems to find the answer. Okay, so here what do we do here? By including, if we can find a solution, then that is fine. Then that means there is a subset which will sum up to the given sum. Or if exclude is true, either include is true or exclude is true, we know that there is actually a subset that will sum up to the given sum. So okay, so if either of them is true, we just return true. This is the solution to the given problem in the top-down approach. Alright, the only thing that we are left with is the base condition. Anyway, once we solve this problem, we'll also look into how to find the actual subset rather than just saying yes, we have found a subset or not. There's no fun in that, right? So let's find the actual subset later. But for now, let's write the base condition. The base condition is one which is corresponding to the smallest subproblem. Okay, so here when we go on looking at the next element onwards, when our I, the current I, goes beyond the array, then that means we have not found any solution. That means there is no subset that sums up to the given sum. But if we find a subset that sums up to the given sum, then that means our remaining sum will be 0. Okay, if our remaining sum becomes 0 by any chance, we just return true. Okay. Otherwise, if my I becomes greater than or equal to n, that means I am going beyond the current element, the array, last element of the array, so I return false. This forms our base condition. So if we run this, we get a value of 1, that means true. So here with this given array with sum 9, we get a value of true as the solution. Now if we consider this example with a sum of 30, there is no subset that forms a sum up to 30. So if we run this, we get a solution of 0, that means false. Okay, so this is the top down solution. Alright, what if we want to print the elements in this solution subset? This solution doesn't give solution subset, it just says whether it's possible to have a subset or not. So one of the things that we can do is, here when include is true, that means by including the current element, we have found a subset that sums up to the given sum. Okay, so that means we have found a solution, that is, we have found a subset which includes this element and still sums up to that given value. Okay, so if we print this, we should get those elements that correspond to the subsets. So here you can see 4 and 5, but this, when you print it here, this will output all the elements that correspond to all the subsets. So 4 and 5 also sum up to 9, and there are other elements 3 plus 4 plus 2 is 6, 6 plus 3 is also 9. So all these elements are included. Okay. What I mean by that is, here there are multiple, since there are multiple subsets possible that will sum up to 9, that is 5 plus 4, 2, 3, and 4, these elements sum up to 9. And by the way, this extra one is the final solution that we are printing. So let me fix this. Alright, when we print it, we get the union of all possible subsets. But what if we want to distinctly print all these subsets? Okay, so one thing that we can do is, since we are printing all the included elements here itself, instead of printing it here, we can do we can store these elements whenever we include. We can keep storing these elements in some kind of stack, keep on adding the elements, and when we reach the end, or when the sum becomes equal to 0, then that means our stack would contain all those elements which we have included, which got us the solution where the remaining sum becomes 0. At that point of time, we can just print all the elements in that stack. Okay, so let's just try that thing. Let's remove this. Let's just take a sample stack with a top equal to initialize to minus 1, and whenever we include, let's add the current element onto the stack. Okay, so plus plus top. We are taking a implementing the stack manually. If you want, you can use the already built-in STL libraries. Okay, so we keep storing when we include, and once we include, we need to look at the exclude choice. So once we try that particular path, the including path, we pop the stack. Okay, in other words, we decrement the top of the stack, top pointer. Okay, now when we reach the sum is equal to 0, that means we have gone through a set of elements by including some of the elements and excluding some of the elements in such a way that at some point of time, when sum becomes 0, then our stack would contain all those elements corresponding to that particular subset. Okay, so let's just print each and every element in that set. I less than or equal to top, because top starts from minus 1. Let's just print those stack elements, and once we are done with printing all the elements in that subset, we just add a new line. So if I print this, you can see that we got all the subsets 3, 4, 2, and 4 and 5. Now, coming to the time complexity of this approach, you can see here that every time we call our function, the operations that we are performing here, all these computations, they take constant time. We have a bunch of if statements, and we have one binary OR operator. So once the function is called, here it's taking constant time, but for every function call, we are making two more function calls. So initially, the one function call makes 2, and 2 makes 4, 4 makes 8, and so on, exponentially in powers of 2. So The time complexity of this is big O of 2 power n, okay, where n is the size of our array. Our number of function calls goes on getting doubled till I reaches the last element. I goes beyond the last element. Okay, so time complexity is 2 power n. Unless we choose to memoize this, at which point it can get reduced to big O of n square or n. We'll be looking at it in the next video, where we'll be looking at the bottom-up approach. Okay, about the space complexity, we are not using any extra space. So if you consider that, we can take this as constant time. But if you want to print the elements, the subset elements, you need some amount of space to store them. In the worst case, it's big O of n space. And here also, it's not exactly big O of 1. It's not constant space, because in a way, you are using function stack space. You have a lot of recursive function calls which use a stack space to keep a kind of extra data about the function. Alright, before we move on to the bottom-up approach, let's just transform this top-down approach in a way that makes it very easier and much more clear when we try to solve the bottom-up approach. Usually when we solve it through the bottom-up approach, we start by taking an example, filling all the values in a table, and then figuring out what is the pattern, a common pattern that arises from that, and then code the solution. You know, all that sequence of steps. So if you try to transform your top-down approach in such a way that instead of looking at the elements from the first element and then going till the last element, if we take a reverse approach where we start by looking at the last element and then go on doing I minus 1 and go on traversing backwards, then the advantage that we get through that approach is our base condition will be related to the first element or an element and or an array with the smallest number of elements or an empty array. So here what I'm saying is, here our base condition is related to n, okay, so the last element, and when we are traversing, we are going deeper and deeper till the last point of our array. Okay, in our recursion tree, if you just draw the recursion tree, this is the approach that we are taking. But if you go on the reverse side, so let's just try that thing. Okay, instead of I, let's start from the last element. And every time, instead of moving forward, let's move backwards. So since we are moving backwards, the base condition is not about checking whether I'm going beyond the array. I just need to check whether I'm going still to the left of the array. So that means my index becomes less than 0. I return false. So what is the benefit here is, when we are solving it through bottom-up approach, we start by solving the smallest subproblem. That means an array with no elements. Okay, that is the smallest subproblem. The next subproblem is an array with only one element. So here, if you model our top-down approach in this way, where we start from the last element and then go on moving to the first element, the advantage is our base conditions are very helpful in modeling the conditions for our bottom-up approach, where we sometimes it's a little bit hard to find what are the initial values that we should be filling in a bottom-up approach. But in the top-down approach itself, if you had modeled it like this, then it becomes easier. Anyway, we'll be looking into bottom-up approach in the next video. But for now, that's it for this video. Hope you guys found this video useful. If you did, please like, share, and don't forget to subscribe. See you guys next time.